Hey, good morning, friends. Happy Wednesday. I'm John Tracy, and I'm so glad that you found your way back here again so that we can connect for some more midweek morning encouragement from God's Word. I want you to listen to what the psalmist says in Psalm 37, 23 through 24. The steps of a man are established by the Lord when he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be cast headlong, for the Lord upholds his hand. I'm so thankful that for followers of Christ, our steps or our life direction and trajectory is established and ordered by the Lord. That's a very comforting promise, wouldn't you agree? But I don't know about you, but as much as I believe that and find hope in it, I also find that to be pretty confusing sometimes because frankly, it doesn't always seem like the circumstances in my life and the decisions I have to make are very established and ordered. In fact, there are a lot of times when I'm just flat out confused and frustrated about what I'm supposed to do next. And it's not because I want to resist God's will in any way. No, it's precisely because I do want to follow God's will for my life. But I don't always know what that is and what it entails. Have you ever been there? Staring down that proverbial hallway at two different doors that you could walk through, both of which would have major consequences for your life direction, and wondering how in the world am I supposed to make this decision? How do I figure out which way I'm supposed to go? How can I know and discern God's will for my life? Maybe you found yourself just wishing that God would, you know, write the answer in the sky or send you a direct message to just tell you what to do. I can for sure relate with all of that kind of wrestling in the heart. This whole topic of God's will, it can be very confusing for us, especially when we hear things like, you know, God's will always happens and God always accomplishes his sovereign will. But then we look around the world and don't we have to ask, well, you know, if that's true, then does that mean that it's God's will for there to be tragedies and natural disasters and violence and crime? And when it comes to my life, you know, can I alter the will of God by my choices? Do I really have any say in the matter at all as to what God's will is for me and for my life? And what if I make the wrong decision? What if I marry the wrong person or take the wrong job or go in the wrong direction? Have I messed up God's will for the rest of my life? I want to see if I can help you with those kinds of things this morning. To do that, it's very important, first of all, that we understand that there is a difference between what is called God's sovereign will and God's moral will. In other words, God's sovereign will, you know, some people will call it his will of decree. That's what always comes to pass no matter what. Like in Daniel 4:35, he does according to his will among the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand. Psalm 115:3, our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. He's doing whatever he wants. So when we talk about the redemptive plan of God that cannot and will not ever be altered or thwarted in any way, we're talking about his sovereign will of the ages. But God's sovereign will is actually different from his moral will. Because while we can't in any way change or contribute to his sovereign will, he does give us the ability to make decisions as to whether or not we will submit to and follow his moral will or his will of command. In other words, on a daily basis, we get to choose whether or not we're going to obey him. And that's why, while it's true that God does all things according to his sovereign will as he pleases, we also have to conclude and affirm that some things happen that are not God's will when it comes to his moral will. 1 John 2:17, whoever does the will of God abides forever, which obviously implies that some don't do the will of God, right? 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, and yet some do perish, which, you know, according to that verse means that's opposite of his will. There are other passages that we could look at to say some more things, but the point is this, that certainly all of us at different times and different ways, we have disobeyed and contradicted and thus resisted the will of God, the moral will of God for our lives. In other words, there's a distinction between God's will as in his purposes that are never frustrated by human involvement and God's will as in his moral commands to humans to act a certain way. One of the clearest evidences of the differences between God's sovereign will and his moral will is the fact that God morally forbids murder in Exodus chapter 23, verse 7. Do not kill the innocent, and yet he willed the murder of his son, didn't he? Listen to Acts 4:27. Truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. So did God sin in willing for his innocent son to be murdered? No, he did not. All his works are right and his ways are just, Daniel 4:37. He works all things according to the counsel of his will, Ephesians 1:11. He did not sin, and the death of Jesus was part of his sovereign will, even though murder is not consistent with his moral will. You see? I think that's really helpful when we look around at all the sin in the world, to understand that God does not sin by allowing sin to exist for a season. His will is always perfect and works toward the fulfillment of his ultimate purposes. But again, it does get pretty confusing sometimes when we start to ponder questions like, you know, what is God's will for my life? You know, usually referring to things like, you know, what job or career should I pursue? You know, where should I live? Who should I marry? What ministry opportunities should I get involved with and commit to? Those are all very important life decisions that do alter my individual life direction, right? But I hope you're starting to see that those kinds of questions and decisions are all typically regarding the moral will of God, not the sovereign will of God. And the moral aspect is that part of God's will that requires spiritual growth and maturity and discernment as I walk with the Lord and follow his commands and apply biblical principles. And so I'm sure you've probably got some of those kinds of questions on your mind right now that involve this moral will of God, don't you? You know, some decision you're praying about that you'd really like to get some clear direction from God regarding? Of course you do. I mean, I do too. And recently I came across a quote from a man named George Mueller. I think it's really helpful along these lines. I'm not sure if you know that name or not. George Mueller, you know who that is? He was the director of the Ashley Down Orphanage in Bristol, England during the 1800s. He cared for 10,000 orphans during his lifetime and was just known by all for a life of dependency on the Lord to provide for his needs and the needs of many children that he cared for. And when he was asked, how do you discern the will of God in making decisions? Here's what Mueller said. I seek at the beginning to get my heart into such a state that it has no will of its own concerning a given matter. 9/10 of the difficulties are overcome when our hearts are ready to do the knowledge of what his will is. Having done this, I do not leave the result to feeling or simple impression. If so, I make myself liable to great delusions. I seek the will of the Spirit of God through or in connection with the Word of God. The Spirit and the Word must be combined. If I look to the Spirit alone without the Word, I'll lay myself open to great delusions also. If the Holy Ghost guides us at all, he will do it according to the Scriptures and never contrary to them. Next, I take into account providential circumstances. These often plainly indicate God's will in connection with his Word and Spirit. I ask God in prayer to reveal his will to me aright. Thus, through prayer to God, the study of the word, and reflection, I come to a deliberate judgment according to the best of my ability and knowledge. And if my mind is thus at peace and continues so after two or three more petitions, I proceed accordingly. Mueller's statement is so wise, isn't it? And it represents exactly what we see in the Scriptures. I would summarize it like this. How can I know God's moral will for my life when it comes to making decisions? Well, first through prayer and Bible study. Psalm 119:105, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. Jeremiah 33:3, call to me and I will answer you and will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. Psalm 143:10, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. So by using Bible-soaked, gospel-soaked logic through prayer and Bible study, I can know God's moral will for my life. But then secondly, through godly counsel, especially as it relates to making sense out of what Mueller called providential circumstances, like those situations that arise that are evidence of the work that only God can do. You know, like when people will sometimes say, that was a God thing. You know, that's what we're talking about. But if it really is a God thing, and not just some emotional delusion or distraction to get me off course, then I'm going to need some godly counsel and input from people who don't have any ulterior motives or competing agendas to help me interpret that. People who have no other reason to counsel me other than to simply help me discern the will of God. Proverbs 11:14, where there is no guidance, a people falls, but in an abundance of counselors, there is safety. Proverbs 15:22, without counsel, plans fail, but with many advisors, they succeed. Proverbs 12:15, the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but a wise man listens to advice. So how can I know God's will? Prayer and Bible study, godly counsel, and one more, through personal desires. Now that might strike you as odd, but I want you to listen to Psalm 37:4-5. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act. You see? God doesn't intend to leave us in the dark on these important life decisions. He doesn't want us to be perpetually confused and frustrated. And get this, following him is not a life sentence to misery. I mean, I think some people are afraid that if they follow God's will for their lives, that they're not going to get to do anything fun anymore. They're going to be perpetually bored and have to spend the rest of their lives doing a bunch of stuff they don't want to do. Well, that's not what the psalmist just said. He said that when you and I delight ourselves in the Lord, in other words, when we seek the Lord's will through prayer and Bible study and godly counsel, little by little, God changes the desires of our hearts. So much so that the things we used to want to do, we don't want to do anymore. We want different things. The direction we want to go is a different direction because God literally changes us from the inside out. And so it really becomes true in the end that the things we end up wanting in life are the very things that God wants for us, because he's the one who put those desires in our hearts in the first place as we sought to follow his will. Now, the order of all that is pretty important, isn't it? I don't want to start with my desires, but after seeking God's moral will through prayer and Bible study and counsel and doing my best to apply gospel-soaked logic to discern providential circumstances, after all of that, it's a very appropriate thing then to simply be asked, well, what do you want to do? Because God is not a God of confusion. And as we seek to know him and to follow him, the desires in our hearts, the very things that we want are the same things that he wants for us to have. So I hope that helps you today in making major life decisions. I hope it encourages you to keep following Jesus with your life, because the steps of a man or a woman really are established by the Lord when we delight in his way. And though you fall, you will not be cast headlong, for the Lord will uphold your hand. God's will may end up being a lot different than what you start out thinking that it's going to be. But I promise you this, it is always the best plan. Have a great day living on mission for Jesus Christ. And I'll see you again soon for more Midweek Morning Encouragement.